Welcome to the latest edition of the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. I'm on a roll now. I've actually remembered the title of my own podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. I am joined in this edition of the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN by Don Devlin. Welcome to the show.
Hello. How are you doing?
I am not bad at all. Thank you very much for asking. How are you today?
I mean, I had a hassle getting ready, but I'm here now.
It's just one of those. I mean, at the moment, we're in a case of we've got so little to do, we just don't want to do any of it as well.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so I mean, well, at the moment, because I do all my recordings when my wife's away, so I'm just like sitting here going, I need to do all this tidying and housework. I don't want to do any of it, so I'll do recording instead. That's a fair use of my time. Anyway, right, so the first question. Absolutely. First question, as always, we'll fire straight into it. How did you get into pro wrestling?
Well, my earliest memory that I can remember for wrestling as a whole was the PS2 game SmackDown Shut Your Mouth, I believe it was called, that my biological father had. And there was times when I was at my great grand, and I would just hide away in my dad's room if my dad wasn't there, and just sit on the PlayStation playing as The Rock, playing as just playing the game. And that's my earliest memory. My earliest memory of actually watching wrestling, however, was WWE Experience Sky One on Sunday mornings.
With Jonathan Coachman. Was that when you were, it was Hibbert time, or was it Scott Sanford?
It was Sanford, I think, yeah. Because I was, I want to say 2010s-ish. It was around the time that Miz had the spinner belt.
About right then, yeah.
It would have been about 10 years ago, because it was like 10 or 11-ish. And I'd actually, WrestleMania 1 year, like I hadn't actually watched any proper wrestling, but like WrestleMania was on pay-per-view, and I'd saved up my pocket money for it, and I'd give it to my parents so that I could watch it. However, I was then not allowed to stay up for it. It's like, okay, no bother, I'll record it. Didn't record the pay-per-view, so I never got to watch it.
Sky Box Office then, $14.95, if I remember rightly.
Yeah, along the lines of that, something like that. So I was relegated to sitting in front of the TV on Sunday mornings watching WWE Experience, because I was very much the most casual of casual fans. I didn't know what channel it was on. I barely knew the wrestlers or anything. Literally the main thing I remember about that era is the match of Cena versus Miz, with Miz getting the title at Mania, the main event. And that's like my earliest proper memories of it. For actually getting into training, that was probably middle of 2016. Literally just googled wrestling training skills Dundee, and the Dundee promotion was the first result. Shot them a message on Facebook and joined their next intake, which was January of 2017. I was in the same intake as James Annett, who was also a referee and announcer. Although I guess he was luckier than me in that he's actually been able to make a technical in-ring debut at Lycra. Which one was it? It was the first Tommy Stevenson that he was in. Whereas I never got to have that honour, unfortunately.
Maybe one day soon. So, must be really weird then, playing SmackDown Shut Your Mouth, it would have had, well, had Rock Hogan on the cover, would have had probably Goldberg or something like that in there. To then watching it in 2010 into 2011, yeah, and like none of them are there.
Yep, I mean, pretty much.
Big Show, possibly. That's probably about it.
Big Show, Henry. Yeah, that's all I can. was Jericho still in the Fed at the time?
Probably. Was he against Fandango that year? I can't remember. No, it was 20.
No, that was later.
Yeah, it was much later. I have no idea. There's this weird time between, say, 2009 and 2015, yeah, where I remember nothing that's happened. I was watching it. I remember nothing of it, though. Yeah, so
10 years ago, I barely remember yesterday.
I know, exactly. Yesterday I spoke to Kenny, and yeah, 2 hours went by, and I don't know what we spoke about. So I don't know how we got 2 hours in. I mean, if you listen to this, you go listen on Patreon, though. So there we go. It's must be super weird. So who are your favourites in the game then? Was it just The Rock, your classics?
Yeah, like honestly, like I remember that I have played it, but I don't remember specifics about the game. I just remember my dad's bed was like this much away from the dresser, and the TV was on top of it, the PlayStation next to it, and I played wrestling and among other games, but I don't actually remember specifics of the game. I remember playing as The Rock, hitting rock bottoms and people's elbows and stuff. And I very, very vaguely remember the graphics.
For me, it's probably my favourite. I mean, a lot of people will go, Here Comes the Pain, and that's absolutely their prerogative, but Shut Your Mouth was just it was my first one on the PS2, so I think it's just more of I didn't have Just Bring It at the time, I had to go to a cousin's to play it. But yeah, I think it's just one of those that I hold near and dear. So when you actually did watch it, so it would have been, so WrestleMania, oh God, what was it? It was, so the one The Rock was hosting.
Yeah, with the blowing giant-ass flamethrower. Lighting up his name.
I'm gonna bring up the card because I cannot remember what it was. 30? No, would it be 30? 27.
Yeah, that sounds. Yeah.
Oh God, it was. Holy shit! It was. Right. Okay.
I remember Mysterio being at Mania that year. I can't remember who he was against.
So this is what you're treated to then. You didn't see the pre-show. Well, you didn't see the show. But Edge versus Alberto Del Rio. That was... Oh, Del Rio won the Rumble that year. Ah, Jesus.
Yeah, I remember I remember watching him debut through Experience.
Okay.
through WWE Experience, I remember
this him. This is your life WWE Experience.
Honestly, up until 2015, yes.
Cody Rhodes versus Rey Mysterio. I remember that was
that's good fun. Yeah, because it was dashing Cody Rhodes with the face mask.
Yeah, because he had to wear it because he got hit by the knee brace of Mysterio or something like that. Yeah,
broke his nose.
He got the core against. Oh, if God. I remember rightly, it was, they called themselves Apple. I can't remember what the acronym was for, but Santino Marella, Kofi Kingston, Kane, and Big Show.
Yeah.
Wow. Randy Orton versus CM Punk. Oh, God. Michael Cole versus Jerry Lawler.
Yes, yes. Oh, no. That was repressed. Repressed those memories.
Well, it's going to get worse as we go along.
With the blooming, the orange singlet with the blooming, the headpiece.
And all the tattoos. He said, you never want to see Michael Cole's body, and that was that.
No.
Undertaker versus Triple H, which ever. And then John Morrison, Snooki, and Trish Stratus.
Oh, God, yes.
Dolph Ziggler and Lee Cool.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. What a WrestleMania. And, of course, The Miz retaining against John Cena. Right, that's quite an introduction then. So
yeah. That's certainly something.
So that was, so we're going for, that was 2011. So you had
2011. Yeah.
So you had 4 years of WWE experience after that.
Pretty much.
So what made you decide to get, do you have a quite a, do you have a sporting background, athletic background before you decided to pursue actually training?
Throughout primary school, like I'm relatively tall until I stopped growing, and then everyone's roughly the same height as me now. I'm 6'1". The reason behind my knees being dead is that I shot up way too quickly, way too fast. I'm pretty sure I was 6 foot by the time I was in like first year. Something crazy. So I was quite tall throughout primary school, and my gran would always pay for me to go to basketball camps, where it was like summer camps where you would go do a week of playing basketball or 2 weeks of playing basketball, and I also did different sports camps. But it was all mainly basketball. No matter how much my dad tried to force me to play football, never been interested in it. As to much as my stepdad and my granddad's chagrin, but besides point. Then, like going into secondary school, I went to Ankrum, like week camp things, where you would do a different outdoor activity each day. So like I've been whitewater rafting with them, I've been gorge walking, hill walking, coast steering, kayaking, canoeing, mainly water sports in that area. I've always been a fan of kayaking, it's relaxing. but outside of summer holidays, the extent of my sports was PE in high school and primary school, where, again, I played basketball or dodgeball. So I guess dodgeball, you just try not to get hit. That's close.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose, I mean, if as long as you adhere by the five rules of dodgeball, of course.
Duck, dive, dip, dodge, and... No, dodge, dip, duck, dive, dodge. That's it.
That's it. That kind of falls into the wrestling. You can apply the rules of dodgeball into actual wrestling itself. So was refereeing what you set out to do initially, or did you want to actually be a pro wrestler?
So I've mentioned this to others in the past, specifically JJ Robin, like who's fellow referee for a long time, is that both of us, like I can't really speak for him, but me personally, I love refereeing. Like, not only is it just it's fun, it's appealing, and it's satisfying. However, I did not join wrestling to be a referee. It's just a happy side thing, sort of thing. And it's a massive bonus that helped me with my wrestling in general, getting that ring time, being out in front of the crowd for so long now, as well as knowing the rules, so to speak, how I can bend and break them potentially. but yeah, it wasn't something I went out to start being, but I have embraced it, and I do enjoy it. But I do hope to debut and wrestle, and for wrestling to be my main thing. And hopefully a certain Perth-based fair promotion will let me do that. Maybe.
Susie, I mean, God knows my shows will actually be around again, but fingers crossed. Right, so going right back to that first day of training then.
Yes.
Your plan set out being you're going to be a pro wrestler. You've seen that on the TV. You've got a bit of an athletic background. What were your first thoughts when you started training? As in the pain or just everything? What was your first thoughts?
I can't remember the exact first day, but my first general thoughts throughout it was, this is a lot harder than it looks. Because, like, we all know it's fake. It's stage wrestling. It's stage fighting. It's play fighting, so to speak. But it's a hell of a lot more physical than you would think it would be. Like, honestly, like, I haven't ever actually been in many fights, but it's a lot more physical than being in an actual fight. Maybe not be as much damaging, but a lot more like effort and thought and activeness needs to go into it, especially nowadays with the quote-unquote indie style of wrestling that's like that a more majority of people would go. I remember for the first 4 or 5 months, I had a purple line across my back from where I was running the ropes. And it wasn't sore, but it was uncomfortable because I wasn't used to it. It definitely looked a lot worse than it did on my back. Same as like with rolls, still not great at them, but like with like obviously I can tumble, like a lot of kids end up learning that when they're blooming totsy. But then with like backwards roll, shoulder rolls, lucha rolls, this like roll this, roll that, it's like, I never knew there was so many different ways to roll and such. And then bumping as well, that's bumping even to this day or to my last training day, it's still something I'm struggling to get my head around, really. I'd missed the training session that our intake had started learning bumps for whatever reason, and then it was never covered again, or at least not back bumps.
Right.
Or at least, yeah. It was, as far as I can remember, it was never covered again. Or at the very least, I was never shown properly how to do it. So I was always doing the bumps where my leg goes up and I just land flat like a plank. if I could even bump, like at the start, I was wrapping my head around making myself fall over. Sorry, put on mute. Was like wrapping my head around and like making myself fall over and landing safely. The first people that took me aside to try and teach me how to bump properly were Scotty Riccio and Pretty Fly for a White Guy, Connor Frost. Ken? Yeah, Connor Frost. It was the two of them that pulled a crash to the side, pulled me to the side, like, right, this is how you do it. And that was my first proper step of learning how to bump that I remember. And then it was very much, this'll do. That's okay. It's not a good bump, but it'll do. Like, that'll get you through any drills that you need to do. And it wasn't until the next intake, which was June or July of that year, 2017, when the Jackal started training. He came back and he started coaching as well. And I joined in with the new intake to learn bumps with him, whilst Stephen Miles taught the rest of the class doing stuff. And honestly, that's like, as well as later on when we were in Manhattan Works with, again, Jackal, that's where I properly started learning to bump and where I could actually get my head around it. Still crap at them. But it was where it was like, okay, this is starting to actually click now. And then when it came to Manhattan Works in mid 2018, I believe, late 2018, start of 2019, I think, when Kevin Williams started coaching as well as Jackal, and between the two of them, I improved significantly. Like, I've still got leaps and bumps to go, but I improved significantly with the two of them coaching me, with like vastly different. They were almost on the opposite ends of each other pardon me, coach style wise. And honestly, like, it helped. It helped so goddamn much. And if I'm honest, if the two of them hadn't been coaching, I probably still wouldn't be able to bump properly. Which is like the most fundamental thing in all of wrestling.
That's what shocks me, that it was done in 1 week and then you're expected to know it the following week and you have to be pulled aside. I think that's the very least you have to know. It's how to fall.
Or at least back bumps were never covered again. I believe we went over front bumps, fishtails and such, but back bumps had never been covered again, as far as I can remember anyways.
It's not like it's the most common bump at all. Right, okay. So, that just baffles me. But anyway, right. So, you went from that, you still do your trading. What was your first refereeing experience? Do you remember the match?
I used to have a notepad on my old phone with every single match I've refereed and the result of that match. I no longer have it because I've got a new phone. I got that a year or two ago, and I no longer have it. I can't remember the exact match, but it was March of 2017. It was the show after Fast Track, because Fast Track, for the first half of the show, I was on outside crew. So I was on, I had the bumming high-vis jacket and I was helping around outside. I was selling raffle tickets. And then the second half of the show, I was on hard cam when Thunder was in the ring. He joined the Rumble, the Fast Track that year. And then it was the month after where me and James started refereeing. However, we did not have a referee shirt. We wore the promotion logo on the black shirt. What was the first match I think?
Because I used to keep track of these events. I have the March 2017 results. So do you remember? Were you right from the start, or was it about halfway through the show?
I wasn't the opener, I don't think. I want to say it was the second or third match.
Well, okay. So I've got... These could be totally out of order. This is how I got the results.
Yeah.
So I've got Stephen Air Miles defeated Chris James. Destruction by Design beat Supercharged.
I read that match.
It was that one.
Yeah, I don't know if that was that one, but I definitely read that match on that show.
So I've got Sami Zayn against Debbie Sharp.
No, I didn't do that. Esther done that one, I believe.
Fortune versus LJT.
No, I didn't ref that one.
Dead Cell against the Scumbucks.
I don't believe so.
Connor Frost versus Stallion.
Yes, I done that. That was my first match. That was my first match. I ref that one. Because that was... Was that Connor Frost retirement match or was that later on?
It ended in count out, so I wouldn't want to believe it would be a retirement match. Because count out's a weird one to end on.
Because the reason that was a count out was LGT music blared. Was that his music player?
They fought each other at Stallion and LGT was that year's Lycra, wasn't it?
It was meant to be.
All right, okay.
But it never happened. I believe that year's Lycra was Stallion versus Mackie.
Mm-hmm.
It was meant to be LGT versus Stallion. However, I can't remember exactly why, but I believe there was issues that had happened or whatever, and LGT wasn't able to make the last couple of months leading up to Lycra and wasn't able to make Lycra. Because then it was either April or May that Mackie faced Stephen Cunningham, who was Belgian. Either Belgian or Dutch. That area. It was either Belgian or Dutch. He'd came over to face Mackie for the title with Misdemeanor on the outside. And I definitely ref that match. Because that also ended in count out. And then one of the other matches that I remember reffing early on was JD Wild versus Stallion. And I don't know if I'll get beat up for saying this, but the ending of that was kind of botched a little bit. And that JD was meant to go for a springboard into a Stallion forearm and then another forearm for the finish. However, JD jumped up for the springboard, his foot slipped on the top rope, and he face planted it in the ring. And that was the first time that I'd ever witnessed a mistake in the ring. I was like, oh crap. It's like, crap, is he okay? Like, I was actually panicking. It's like, this is not the finish. this is not how it's meant to go down. But thankfully, the two of them are brilliant professionals, and they managed to get it back on course and put it into the finish and finish it.
So it was a fair learning curve straight away then.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, you're doing title matches within your first 3 months.
Yeah.
Even if it's, I mean, it's still their flagship title. So of course, if something goes wrong, if you make a mistake, then it could throw months of work out the window for a little bit. So who would you say out of the matches that you've refereed over the years? So that's supposed to be a couple of years now. You've done them
3 years, roughly.
What would be some of the biggest matches you've been able to referee?
The biggest matches I've been able to referee. I done the last match, not the main event, because it was pushed on backstage. It was not the main event. It was the last match of the show. At Lycra, of the promoter versus the most hated guy in Scottish wrestling at the time. In a mixed tag match with Esther and Misdemeanor. That was something. That was something.
It's one of those things you can't... Like, how much can you speak about it?
Because obviously, I don't want to talk bad about it, because I very much doubt I would have done well in the last match, not the main event, the last match of Hell for Lycra. I would not have been able to do any better. I definitely, like, to even just be in the ring wrestling, of like that's like props to you, like, because my first Lycra, my very first match was, I want to say, Ryan Severn versus the Riot Chris James versus KJ Nitro. That was it. It was a triple threat in the first match, and I was refereeing the opener. So obviously, with the, it's like the curtains, the stage, and then you can either step down or hop across onto the ring, and that's a little bit lower than the stage. So you come up the curtains, and obviously all the lights are facing you, so you don't really see past the ring, and there's only two rows of fans on the stage. Like, this isn't bad at all. So I hop over onto the ring, step in, white feet, start conversing with Matt Kelly, who was announcing at the time, and then Chris James makes his entrance. He circles his way around the side of the crowd, down the steps, side of the ring, and I started doing what I always done at the time, was that I watched the wrestlers walk around the ring, make sure there's no shenanigans, etc. So he goes around to the back side of the ring. That's when I see all the fans, and my anxiety starts hitting me like hell. I was like, oh god, there's so many people. I am not used to this many people. And I was pissing myself.
So that was Caird Hall, wasn't it?
Yes. Which was, as far as I know, out of the three times that I've done Hell for Lycra, three times that I've done Hell for Lycra there, 2017, 2018, 2019, that was the most fans we had in attendance there, because 2018 was less, and then 2019 was more so less. But like, I still have that feeling in the pit of my cut. I can remember that viscerally. like, I was always... I don't want to say I was a nervous wreck, but like, whenever I was refereeing, like, whenever, as soon as I'm behind the curtains, like, I need a piss, no matter how many times I would go to the bathroom, it's like, I'm needing the piss, I'm so nervous. And then I would get out into the front of the crowd and I'd be fine and get it. But that match was the most nerve-shattering match I've ever refereed. That first one at Hell for Lycra. I also got to referee Zack Sabre Jr. versus Stephen Air Miles. At Fast Track, where that was at Friary. I believe that was at the Friary. I could be wrong. Just off the Lockheed Road. That was a big match for me, because that was the... Because I see... Zack Sabre Jr. as not as an idol, but someone is that that's the sort of wrestling I love doing, and he's one of the biggest names that does submission style wrestling that's like mainly catch wrestling, I guess, like catch wrestling leaning more on the submission style. And the first time I met him, when I shook his hand, I'm not embarrassed to admit that I was a little starstruck. And the fact that I was getting to referee his match was something else entirely. But then I got in the ring and it was almost different mindset. It's like, right, referee mode on. So that's probably the only thing that I don't like about refereeing. I don't get to watch those matches. I'm too invested almost in refereeing and focused on refereeing that I don't get to enjoy the match as a whole, because I'm too close to it almost.
Oh yeah, I mean, I suppose you're watching it and just going, right, I can't, yeah, you can't enjoy it because making sure you're making sure everything's on time, you're making sure the guys are safe, you're making sure everything's going to a general plan that was discussed beforehand. That does kind of make it difficult. So Zack Sabre Jr., any other the big names?
Memorable-wise, I also refereed Sam Gradwell versus the Jackal. I actually had a list. And it's all just farted. My brain sharted it out.
That would have been the Lycra year that they had the best of
the
Britain.
The UK folk, yeah.
Yes, with CJ Banks, Mark.
Because that was when Zack Sabre Jr. was meant to be there and face Miles at Lycra for the heavyweight. However, I believe it was travel issues to do with planes that he wasn't able to make it, which is how he was then later booked for Fast Track against Miles, and which was then Muscle Cat went against...
Saxon Huxley, is it?
Yes, Huxley. I couldn't remember his first name, so I just remembered his nickname. I was like, yep, that's definitely right. It was Saxon Huxley versus Miles that year instead. Because originally, Huxley was meant to face someone else. I can't remember who. Who else have I... One of my other most memorable matches was actually an Uprising extra that it was the Scumbucks of Ambrose, JD and Eddie versus Spike Tierney, Cage Nitro and Jay the Jackal, which is a very odd pairing. I very much lost control during that match. That was my first ever six-man tag match, and I very much lost control of that. Like, I was told I was going to anyways, that I shouldn't worry too much about it. But six men in the ring at once is impossible to track.
So as far as refereeing itself, you've been to a few companies now, but is there any, idols, I suppose would be the word, any referees that you kind of try and get pointers out of? I'm assuming guys like is it Aubrey Edwards and
yes,
Earl Hebner, all your kind of
so known, like,
referees.
Sometimes, like, if it's a big match, I'll watch it through normally and just enjoy it for what it is, and then. Sometimes I'll watch it a second time and try and just watch the referee, which obviously is very difficult a lot of the time because the focus is on the wrestlers, is never on the referee unless there's shenanigans afoot. But I'm also in a Facebook group called Zebra Talk, which is referees from all across the globe, from multiple different promotions, including WWE, Impact, AEW, PWG, I believe Red Shoes is also in the group. It's just, there's German referees, there's British referees, there's Spanish, there's Mexican. It's just a massive amalgamation of so many people, and that was created by Odie Brown, who works mainly East Coast, West Coast, not East Coast, so that there's that resource for referees that they can pitch questions there if they need to, they can get help if they need to, potentially even help each other get bookings and such. When I was across in Florida a year and a half ago, I was in contact with someone from Zebra Talk, and I was potentially going to be able to referee matches across there, which would have been fantastic. Like, I'd brought all my kit just in case. however, I was not able to, because obviously, Florida in itself is almost the size of the UK. I was unable to get the transport from where I was staying to where the shows were. So, unfortunately, it fell through. But even just to have that opportunity, because of the network of referees there, is fantastic.
So like I said, so use Zebra Talk to kind of coordinate a little bit, and you watch back matches. Like I say, is there any particular referees that you think, right, that's the kind of thing I'm going for? Referees are supposed to be kind of...
Yeah, for mainstream referees, it would probably be Aubrey Edwards or Mike Yoda, when he was still refereeing for the Fed. For more indie, for more local, I looked to Sean McLaughlin, and just sounds weird saying it, but watch what he does. Is that like not specifically him, but like I try and watch what he does in matches, same as with Aubrey and even Rice Benford. I'm blanking with names now. This has just all went down the gutter with my head. But like I try and watch them and figure out, like, okay, this is one way that you can do this in this situation. And then I might watch another person's like, okay, this is what they did in this situation. So then there's multiple avenues that you could potentially have as well.
Cool. That's right. So we'll move away from reffing. Yes. As it seems to have kind of bettered down a little bit with remembering names.
Sorry.
That's cool. So last year when lockdown hit, of course, there's no match as the referee, there's nothing to do. Yes. Yeah, took part in our Battle Bowl.
Yes, with Caleb Valhalla.
Which with Caleb Valhalla. He did win that.
Yes.
I wrote that down and then I just went.
Honestly, right. He carried that. I have no idea. Like, even I am still shocked. Like, I have no idea how that happened. Like, Caleb had to have carried that. There was no way any of that was on me whatsoever.
I'll be honest, I was kind of shocked as well that the guys went through. So I was like, oh, all right, okay.
No name referee this worked at that point in three promotions and only really properly in one that doesn't really cross over anywhere else. Like, how?
So we did that. And how else are you keeping busy during this lockdown period?
Gaming and binging Netflix and movies.
What's your current Netflix binge?
The current one I'm watching is... I'm watching a couple different things. Because if I watch one too much at once, I'll get burnt out on that. And I then end up can't watching it ever again. I'm currently watching The Digimon Adventures 2020 on Crunchyroll, which is just like a reboot of the original... Digimon Adventures with like Agumon, Gabumon, and all them from 97-98. I've also started watching Bad Blood and Fate, the Wink Saga. I've just finished Sons of Anarchy, and before that, I've just finished Sabrina. And honestly, I'm in love with Sons of Anarchy. I want a sequel of that.
Never seen
that. I highly recommend it. You might have to push through the first episode or two, but it is fantastic. It's fantastic. Like, I highly recommend it. It was probably my favorite series that I've watched during lockdown, honestly. I can't give it enough praise, honestly.
No, we've been trying to get through things. We're now into a second watch of New Girl. Just going through all of that again. I started watching Superstore. It's just kind of bog standard.
Saw that shown, and the title picture for it certainly looks interesting.
It's just like, I think it's kind of, not trying to be Brooklyn Nine-Nine, but it's that kind of style.
Okay, yeah.
As in,
I get you.
It's a bit silly. There's no laugh track, which I love. I hate laugh tracks in things. That's why my favorite show ever is Scrubs, because it's funny.
Okay, yeah.
No laugh track. Don't need to think about it. I know when I need to laugh. It's pretty much what I'm thinking out of it.
Mine's is probably 99.
Yeah, 99 is probably up there. I think because it's newer, it's not just reached Scrubs level for me, because I've watched that since I was way younger.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, 20 years ago, something like that, it started. Something
when I was your age.
Exactly. When I was young, it was Turkey GD, and that was the end of matters.
Yeah.
But yeah, Brooklyn Nine-Nine's up there as well. I really enjoyed Big Bang Theory, but I got fed up because, like I say, it was telling me when to laugh. It was like,
it was funny. It was okay. It wasn't fantastic, but like if it was on, I wouldn't turn it off.
Yeah. Same with Friends. It's like, well, I like Friends' first run, but now I'm like the thousandth viewing. It's one of those where I'll just keep it on. It's fine.
I've still never watched that all the way through. Because obviously it was out around about the time that I was born, so it's a little bit before my time, making everyone feel old.
Exactly. Yeah. So like 2011, I was 21. I could drink when I was watching the first WrestleMania that you were watching. That's how old I am.
2011, I was 13.
Oh God. Jesus. So you started watching wrestling 13 then? That was your kind of your starting point?
Roughly, yeah.
All right. Yeah, 2010. What a lean year to go into. Right, so you mentioned Digimon.
Yes.
From my very brief research, I know you're a bit of a fan of the old anime stuff. As anyone's listened to previous podcasts for myself, I know next to fuck all about anime. So, what would be your recommendations for any newbie that goes into it? I've seen Pokemon. I assume that's much such the same.
Like, sorry, one second. Sorry, something back in my throat. Now, compared to like a casual person, I am definitely a weeaboo. However, I would not call myself a weeaboo. That is peak cringe, no. But for anyone that's just getting into anime, I'd definitely recommend Fullmetal Alchemist. Specifically, Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood. So there is a distinction between the two. There's Fullmetal Alchemist, which is the original one, and then from what I understand, Fullmetal Alchemist is essentially, or Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, or FMAB, is essentially FMA abridged. So if you're familiar with the Dragon Ball abridged, which literally, like, Dragon Ball goes from, like, hundreds upon hundreds of episodes, like 500, 600s, then into abridged, which is like 100 to 200 episodes. It cuts out so much filler that it's like episodes that you just don't really need to see, that were there to fill out weekly television sort of thing. Another one I suggest is probably 7 Deadly Sins. That's also a good one for starting. If you're wanting to watch old school, like less modern, and you can watch through it and you're willing to watch many hundred episodes, Dragon Ball, Bleach, One Piece, Naruto, the stereotypical things, like if you're willing to sit down for weeks and watch a whole series, definitely any of them. Also Digimon Tamers, which was a little bit of a pull away from the rest of the two Digimon series before it. However, my opinion, that's the best one. The third season, Digimon Tamers with Guillermon, Terriermon, and Renamon, that was my favorite. other animes to watch, I could probably pull up a watch list actually because I've got Crunchyroll on my phone.
While you're doing that, then I need a bit of dictionary definition here. Weeaboo, is that newbie?
So no, a weeaboo is someone who is obsessed with anime, right.
Totally
manga, and Japanese culture in general. So, like, the British version of a weeaboo is a teaboo. Did not know that until recently, and I find that hilarious. so, like, a weeaboo is someone that's very much into anime, is like, will watch 90% of animes that are out there, has got wall scrolls with Naruto on there, has got so many different cosplays and costumes, their entire watch list of everything, like movies and television wise, is only anime. Like, it's the people that you look at as like, maybe tone it down a notch. Like, it's liking anime is their entire personality almost. And it's, as the kids would say, quite cringe. so yeah, it's like it's less used in that context now. It's kind of evolved more on to just someone who likes anime. Same as how, like, because, like, originally it was an insult, similar to, like, geek and nerd. Whereas, like, now people use it as, like, a badge of honor almost. Whereas a weeb nowadays is just someone who likes anime, someone that watches a decent amount of anime. It's more than just a casual viewer, so to speak. As for modern, so definitely, like, recent anime, like the past year or two, for ones that I would definitely recommend: Fire Force, Dr. Stone, The Rising of the Shield Hero. Honestly, that's probably my favorite anime now, is The Rising of the Shield Hero, because it's just the character developments in it and the story developments. It's got its obligatory beach episode, but it still turns it into an actual thing and not just a fan service bullshit episode where you just see anime titties. It's actually used for the story. Still a little bit weird to see them in a summery beach location in swim attire opposed to full armor, but it makes sense in the story. So it's find my books.
Right, that actually leads to a very good question I've got from Dylan Hendry. He asked, most bizarre anime plot that you've watched?
The most bizarre anime... The first one? The very, very first one that comes to mind is... For a specific... like story arc opposed to an overall story, the first like story arc is probably in the original Digimon Adventures, where I believe it's Matt and TK and Mimi, three of the main characters the Digidestined, are in like this preschool area, so with all these like baby Digimon, and suddenly they're attacked by Numimon, which are these like green slug things with big blooming eyes poking at the top of their head, and they throw pink poop. That is their whole gimmick.
Yeah.
That is their whole, like, that's the only thing Numimon does, throws pink poop. And that is one, like, they've essentially got to save the nursery Pokemon from Numimon and their boss, so to speak, Monzimon, which is big yellow teddy bear thing. As for overall anime, there's an anime I'm tempted to mention, but that could potentially get me put on some watch lists, so I don't want to. And if anyone that watches anime heard of Boku, that's all I'm going to say. Do not search it. You do not want that on your search history. If anyone ever tells you to watch an anime that starts with Boku, you're far clear. That is cursed, and I'm pretty sure borderline illegal.
okay.
Yes. Then there's High School DxD, which is literally just fan service. It's like anime girls with throwing boobs flying everywhere, guns. That's anything that's just like very clearly fan service. One that's a weird. It's not a it's not obscure, but it's a weird story. But they've definitely pulled it off well. But here, that time I was reincarnated as Slime. So literally, like the opening bit is the main character dies, and then he wakes up as like a slime in like a sort of MMORPG world. So like a Monster Hunter style world. He wakes up as this small blue slime, and he ends up becoming the most powerful person in the world, and it's interesting, and it's also that's a good one as well.
So you mentioned Weebos, they've immersed themselves in all this culture. You mentioned cosplay.
Yes.
Am I right to think you do a bit of cosplaying yourself?
Yes, I love cosplay.
Mainly anime stuff, or anything that I may have heard of.
The one you'll most likely have heard of is Anarchy from which Arkham game was it? Anarchy from the Arkham games. White baller suit with a puffer jacket. Red, not white. Red boiler suit with a puffer jacket with a big A spray painted on the side. White anonymous style mask. So like, but without the facials on it. It's just a plain white mask. A red hood. Who does what his namesake is. He wants anarchy. He's one of the bosses in not Arkham Asylum, the second game.
It's Arkham City.
Yes. He's one of the bosses in that. And that was the first proper cosplay that I had, as well as the only cosplay that I've properly made myself. And it is shit, but I love it. And it is boiling as heck to wear, because it's a scarf, it's a puffer jacket, it's a big boiler suit, it's a mask, you cannot breathe in it, and I love it.
So I like the sound of doing it. I think I've never found something that I could pull off, and I think eventually once we can do things like Halloween, I'll go for the old Lebowski Thor look, mainly because I've got the beard, I've got the hammer, I'm halfway home. I can look homeless.
Probably the best thing about cosplay is that you don't even have to like naturally look like the character. So there is such a thing as crossplay, so like CROSS, which is where you choose a character of a different gender, swap it. So like you might want to cosplay as Ash Ketchum but as a girl, or as Hatsune Miku as a guy. And so that's like it's flipping the script almost. Like you're still cosplaying that character, but you're not the same gender as them. So it's just how you believe they would look as the opposite gender. Then there's also just in general, you don't even have to look like a character to cosplay them. Like honestly, none of the characters I cosplay, I would say I pull off well, but I still love cosplaying them.
It's just about the passion, isn't it? It's about the passion doing it. So we're going to swing back to referee briefly, because again, I'm just going, most of these notes are off the top of my head, just I'm thinking where you would have refereed. So of course, Dundee being the obvious one. All right, I'm thinking W3L.
Yes, I've done galas and I've done one showdown.
Fair City. You've done Fair City as well?
Yes, I've done two out of three of those shows.
Anywhere else?
No, unfortunately not yet.
That's fine. So my brain was like, yes, that must be the three. Excellent. Yes. So FCW, the ones at Fair City, their shows have just been insane, cars top to bottom.
Definitely.
So as far as, I mean, you mentioned some of your favourite matches that you've refereed, or some of the bigger names, I should say. Mm-hmm. Is there any particular matches that for a moment even took you out of the old referee mindset from across all companies that you've been like, wow, this is an amazing match at the time? Or are you quite good at keeping Screwed On?
I'm keeping good at Screwed On, but one, like, there was a little while where I kind of had the bad habit of going into autopilot with refereeing, where I wouldn't necessarily zone out, but I was going through the motions. And that was until JD Wild versus Spike Tierney at the Tulloch Institute. And I was pulled out of it, not for good reasons. Spike was on the top rope. JD went up to give a superplex. One, two, JD goes for it. Spike's thingy card cover, but the woman's shin cover gets caught in the turnbuckle. Spike goes up, goes straight down, head first, in front of the thing, as does JD. And that I panicked because, like, holy fuck, someone has to be hurt from this. Like, if you'd seen that match or seen that spot, like, you'll 100% know what I mean. With Spike being, like, I know this wasn't the correct way of dealing with this, but with Spike being the way that he is, with always wanting to do neck bumps, always wanting to do those dangerous bumps where he flips inside out and lands on the top of his neck, where he's going to hurt himself someday. But somehow he has a rubber neck and he is yet to do so. And because that's the way Spike is, I checked on JD first. And after that match, after watching that spot back, I know that I did that incorrectly, that Spike would have, like, thankfully neither of them were hurt, but if either of them had been hurt, Spike would have been the one that was more seriously hurt. Yeah, it was just like that pulled me out of refereeing for all the wrong reasons, really. On a brighter note, one of my favorite matches to have refereed was I believe it was the blow off match of Zach Leon and Alex Webb. And it was a no DQ match and it was brutal. And yeah, and like I enjoyed it. I enjoy it. Like, it was obviously as much as you can enjoy a hardcore match. I do like myself hardcore wrestling, but I know some people absolutely detest it, but I enjoyed watching that match as well as like refereeing that match. It was nice. It was good. It was fun. Because I believe that was the blow off to their big feud that was happening where they'd started off tag teaming. They were tag team for a good few months, and then they imploded, and then they had a feud together. And I'm wanting to say I refereed most, if not all, matches in that feud, which I am happy to say.
So I'm glad you ended that whole bit on a positive note. So that's
actually, I don't know why I completely forgot this. And I am going to get murdered for forgetting this. Jay Robin versus John Kerr for the Showcase title. That is the happiest I've ever been at an outcome of a match. Because, like, Jay is probably the person that I'm closest to within all of wrestling. He is the one that, like, honestly, if it wasn't for him, I would probably still be wallowing about in the training center, just puttering on, going for it. Whereas Lydia Falls was Jay's idea. And gave me something to strive for, and like, because obviously I obviously want to debut and wrestle, but I didn't really have a gimmick. I had a style of wrestling I wanted to do. That was it. Having Lydia Falls there was something to strive towards, and to have my man win the showcase title, I was honestly in tears afterwards. Like, it was the happiest I've ever been. I was told one ending was happening. I was told that John Kerr was going over. John Kerr came out, done his checks and everything. And John says to me, "Jay's going over." Now, previous to this, I'd heard of a story between Demo and Ambrose, where Ambrose pinned Demo not knowing that he was meant to be going over. He thought that Demo was going over, and Demo just didn't kick out. So my first reaction was, does Jay know that Jay's going over? And yeah, he did, fortunately, so I did not have to keep that a secret. I probably would have been grinning ear to ear most of that match. It was a somber occasion, because it was John Kerr's second to last match with the Dundee promotion. And it was Jay Robbins' only match with, like, being, like, only singles match with being a showcase champion that he apparently tarnished. Tarnished one, maybe. I'm just making side swipes. Yeah, like, it was, that was probably the happiest I've ever been for an outcome of a match, because none of us really expected it to happen, because it was his singles debut was beating, like, was it? Oh, singles debut on the main roster. And it was beating a champion for a title. It's just amazing. Oh, yeah.
Sorry.
That's
so we'll just wrap up. We'll do a little bit of, because it's going to come out on the week of the Royal Rumble, so we'll speak about that in a sec. Because I'm assuming that you still watch the WWE.
I haven't been watching that as much recently, but yes, I still watch it.
Cool, that's fine. But who would say who are your top five favorite wrestlers right now? Then I'm assuming Jack Sabre Jr. is you like the technical. Catch kind of wrestling. So who's your fave five right now is in the
top five at the moment? Chucky T, Cesaro, Tama Tonga, Miro is still up there. Probably. Did I say Big E?
You didn't say Big E. So Big E round off.
Well. Yeah.
That is not the five I was expecting when you're saying for, like, Jack Sabre Jr. Yeah. I was thinking there was going to be like Daniel Bryan.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
For like female wise, it's probably like Bayley. Bayley's having a fantastic go at it just now. Io. Nyla Rose, Toni Storm, and Rhea Ripley are for my girls.
So, that seems like a pretty good mix of, yeah. I mean, we're blessed right now being in the year of 2021, and even though there's no wrestling going on locally, or shouldn't be. We're quite blessed with fantastic wrestlers on TV that we can watch. So we're going to speak about Royal Rumble then, very briefly. We're just going to maybe prepare predictions, things like that, because it's probably my only, this will be the only recording I do before Royal Rumble, that we can speak about it, because otherwise, I mean, I think the next episode I've got coming out of the actual mainline podcast, I recorded back in November, so It'd be very weird if I was able to do it then and have any sort of accuracy. Well, before I do that, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur? Yeah. What? I knew this was going to be coming. Why is this catching?
I like to sneak it in now. I don't even wind it up. I just throw it in just before something else to keep it fresh.
Ankylosaurus.
See, bloody Ankylosaurus, and that's popping up a lot.
Really?
Yeah. Ankylosaurus, Velociraptor.
How many T-Rex?
Well, in the actual podcast, not a lot of T-Rexes, but they won our dinosaur, favorite dinosaur in our podcast award.
Maybe a Spinosaurus from Dinosaur King. Spinosaurus, let's go, Dinosaur King.
But no,
that's another anime. It's like based off of a card game sort of thing. It's just, yeah.
But no, Ankylosaurus, it's popping up a lot in this question. And I did not expect it. I thought it was going to be Triceratops was one mentioned a lot in the early episodes, and then
hazard a guess why I like an Ankylosaurus. Starts with D and ends in Mon.
Fair enough. Right, so Royal Rumble. Who are your predictions then? Men's Rumble winner? Rumble winner.
It has to be whoever is facing Reigns at the Rumble. Like, the winner is going to go on to face... not the Rumble. Whoever's going to win the Rumble is going to face Reigns at Mania. I'm going to call that. And I think a big chance of winning it is Big E. Or maybe Cesaro.
Cesaro's getting quite a lot of wins at the moment. I think he's going to be fairly far into it.
Both are superb single stars. Obviously, on my top five. Both are, specifically Cesaro recently, both have been getting good wins and good momentum going. And there was a thing between, I might remember, there was a thing between Reigns and Big E recently. Backstage, and honestly, both of them deserve a main title run. It's like, but at the same time, I don't know if you can dethrone Reigns yet.
See, for me, I think it's going to be Cesaro Bryan as the final two.
I can see that.
Bryan is going to win because I think they teased Bryan and Reigns right at the start of the year or tail end of last year.
Meant to be Rumble.
Yeah, then it never went anywhere. But I think they're going to keep it. They've kept that locked in the back of mind because Reigns versus Daniel Bryan, that's a good WrestleMania match. And then Reigns winning it makes him even more of a big bad bastard because he's beaten
I could see that. Yeah,
Daniel Bryan. Female Women's Rumble.
It's going to be Flair again, isn't it?
Nah, Bailey.
Maybe Belair.
I'm going for Bailey Banks at WrestleMania, so I need a Bailey win at the Rumble.
Okay, I can very much see that. I could see Belair winning it. I could see Baszler winning it. But Bailey's probably the best choice, honestly.
Because I think she was on about...
Unless they want to have a fucking swerve ball.
Probably Flair. They've kind of went on about her accomplishments and having all and doing the big grand slam, but that means the only thing she hasn't got is the Rumble. So I think that's hopefully the way to go. But I mean, either way, I'm starting a new job on Monday and I should really be live and kicking and awake, but I'm still going to stay up.
But you won't be.
I will be staying up for the Royal Rumble. I'm working from home. I can look like shit on Monday. I don't care.
I assume you'll have copious amounts of coffee.
I don't drink it, but it'll be Monster. I'll be purchasing some Monster to keep me going.
That is fair.
just the one, though, because I find if I have two, for some reason, there's one Rumble year I had three. And I felt like I wanted to die around about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning because my heart was going like the clappers going, I'm going to die tonight. And I've just, I don't know if it was more of a case of I just watched Drew win it or the three monsters, but I'm fairly certain there's a combination that caused my wanting to dyness from that. Right, so we're going to get more fan questions or more questions in. We've got Jetstream Jack. He asked, most overrated Yu-Gi-Oh card?
VFD.
Is that something with a dragon?
Yeah. I can't remember the actual name of it. True King of All Calamities. It's a rank 9 Xyz monster that essentially just says no. However, everyone plays a card named Infinite Impermanence, which is a trap card that you can play from the hand, negate a monster effect. It's not as bad as it is, and unless it's like that, none of this will make any sense to you, but anyone that's like...
Anyone's watching the video right now, they've just seen me glaze over, just going, yeah, I have no idea what I'm about.
Anyone that's like, that pays attention to Quarantine Yu-Gi-Oh! So like Quarantine series by Simo and all that, unless you're playing likes of some weird Datascape build or virtual world build or some jank as shit Drytron build where you can somehow get two VFD out and other shit. If someone ends on just one VFD, maybe a VFD in Dragoon, they're bored shit. Don't get me wrong, True King of All Calamities needs banned. That is a stupid card because it literally just says no to monsters. But it's not anywhere near as bad as people make it out to be.
I'm just going to agree with you. Yeah. I mean, my only Yu-Gi-Oh card I know is Blue Eyes White Dragon. So, I mean...
Yeah, most people think like Blue Eyes White Dragon, maybe Dark Magician...
Dark Magician. I remember that one. I remember Dark Magician. That one got played a lot by, I don't know, Kai.
Yugi, my or boy.
Whatever. I don't know.
Dark Magician was Yugi and Blue Eyes White Dragon was Kaiba.
Ah, right, okay. Like I say, Pokemon was as far as I got with anime. I tried to watch One Punch Man, and then after I watched about three episodes, I was like, all right, I get the premise of this. He can punch people with one punch. He doesn't like it. There we go. All right, cool. Don't need to watch anymore. I think I've kind of got it.
I'm obsessed with the Digimon games just now, specifically over quarantine. Like, I got Cyber Sleuth. I'm struggling with it, I'm not going to lie. It's the only JRPG game that I've really enjoyed. I've got like 130 odd hours in it. I'm 16 chapters into one of the games, 3 chapters into the other. And I enjoy it so goddamn much, and it's revitalized my passion for Digimon, which is why I'm obsessed with it just now.
The game I'm playing Psychonauts at the moment, because
I played a little bit of that.
I said it in a past podcast, but I said it in Kenny's, which is coming out in like 2 months. That I really wanted to. I want to play a Spyro kind of style game. I've got the trilogy. I played them. So I want to play something like that. So I played Ratchet and Clank, and now Psychonauts is next. And I have no idea how far along I am in the story. I think I've only done like maybe 2 or 3 boss levels, and I'm kind of enjoying it. There's moments where I'm sitting there going, I'm fucking stuck. And then I'll come back the next day and go, I'm through it. So, how what the fuck happened there?
With Cyber Sleuth, it took me 60 or 70 hours to find out that you could go to talk to a person if you're lost and don't know where you're going.
Oh, Jesus.
It took me 60 or 70 hours to find out that that was a thing. Only proper memories of, I think, I wanted to say it was Psychonauts, was back in the day of like the original Jingle Jam was the Yogscast DLC for it. Which was like several years ago. That's my like. I want to say it was Psychonauts.
I've been playing it on mute, so I don't know if they've mentioned any of that, because I just play podcasts in the background.
Yeah.
I don't listen to my old one because that would be really.
Why not? Free views.
I don't like hearing my own voice. That's the thing.
Okay, I get that. I very much get that.
And because I wear. The beats are kind of, they're not totally like noise cancelling, but they are enough. So when I'm listening back to it, I'm shouting because I'm trying to hear my voice, but the headphones are covering my ears, so I can't hear my voice. I feel like I've got to shout to hear me so that you can hear me. So it's just, I can just hear myself just going, I'm shouting really loud in this podcast. I'm not.
Honestly, how I feel with these. I got these at Christmas, and this is a different experience having like them in full ear opposed to, I don't even know what my old, like I've got old Turtle Beaches that, oh, here they are, that didn't really cover the full ear and did the job. And to then go from Turtle Beach to Razor, it's just something else.
Yeah, I was looking at headphones. I was like, oh, these are great. These are noise cancelling. Totally ones one of them anyway. And I looked at it, I thought, oh, I can't hear a thing. And I really realised, I have a dog to walk. That's not the best idea. I think I need something that I can hear a little bit.
because yeah, I went about, I just use earphones.
I just use these, so it tells people, fuck off, don't talk to me.
I don't quite bring the cat ears outside.
But no, I like to wear headphones people can see so they know not to speak to me, because I don't want to speak to them. That's the worst thing about having a dog. The worst thing about having a dog is the dog owners think that they get to speak to you because they also have a dog.
Hi, how is he doing today?
No, fuck off. They can play in the field. I will stand here and look at my phone until she comes back. I've got a girl dog. Until she comes back. That's fine. That works for me. I don't need to care about your day. Fuck off. Anyway, so I had a last question before we do social media bits. Jason Hyde asked, who's winning a game of chess, Nicki Minaj or Cardi B?
I'm trying to remember who Cardi B is.
She's like Nicki Minaj.
Yeah, I know. Because it's literally like Nicki Minaj, Cardi B, Megan Thee Stallion. It's like, which one's which again? I want to say Cardi B just because, from what I remember, Nicki Minaj is dippy as heck and is very much just a bimbo.
There's a word you don't get in a podcast often, dip it. That's the next level, glake it.
It's drink it outside.
Yes. Just because you're from Dundee, and it's popped into my head because I now have a TikTok, which... Oh, I never thought I would. I know, it's scary. I don't do any of my own videos because that would just be weird.
I mean, I've got the Miku stump and TikToks in my head, so it's fine.
But how? What do you call a pie?
It depends.
Don't throw pear at me. That's just weird.
It's a pear. It's like if I'm speaking Scottish, like if I'm speaking Dundonian, it's a pear.
Say, don't, you're not tarring Scotland with that brush, it's Dundonian.
If I'm speaking Ori as fuck, like if I'm like Denny Ken, what the fuck are you on about? If I'm speaking Ori as fuck, it's a pear. He's a pear. He's a fucking pear new. if I'm just normal, it's a pie. But it's like one thing I love getting any non-Scottish friends to say is twa pies are plain and a ning a ning a na. Two pies, a plain one, and an onion one as well. And listening to Americans try and say it is fucking hilarious.
But it's one of the first videos I saw. It's this boy going, in Scotland, we call this a pear. Do we? Fuck. Go away with that. let's not get into butties. That just sounds like that's just going to get into an argument. But anyway, so
like,
thanks.
Like chip butty, bacon butty.
No. Buttery.
Yeah.
No. Buttery. Buttery.
Butty.
Buttery.
Butty.
Chip butty, or I agree with, but buttery. Or rowie. Is that what?
What the fuck is a rowie?
I have no idea. I call it a buttery.
I mean, do you mean like a bap?
No. Right, okay, right, we're going to get into a fight. So we'll just finish up from there. So thank you for joining me. This has been Don Devlin on the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. Where can people find you on social media, Twitch and whatever? Where can people find you?
Oh, crap. I've got a link tree someplace. My Twitter is at Lady Lockhart, LadyLockheart. Feel free to add me on Facebook. Might not accept you because if I've at least met you before, feel free to add me on Facebook with my full name, Don Devlin. I'm on Twitch and I am also Lady Lockhart on there. Let me double check. Yes, I am, spelt same way. Steam, I am Firestarter Funk from when I originally got my Steam name. It's FireStarterFunk. And my Discord, if you want to add me on Discord for whatever heckin' reason, is Lady Lockhart, spelt the same way. #255 One sec, let me double check.
Oh, Discord just confuses me. People say, are you on Discord? I don't know how to. Don't even know what my
Discord is. Where the hell is my number? I've always lost my number. Where is it? I've lost it. I've lost it.
Fine, I'm sure if you go into the Twitter or Facebook, it'll be there somewhere.
If not, you can message me on Facebook and I can send it.
Excellent. But thank you for being on our Untitled show. I've learned stuff about anime that I may forget, but I've at least asked the questions.
How dare you forget it? Pop quiz, what is a weeaboo?
Oh, God. someone who really likes the Japan.
Yeah, the Japan.
but thank you for joining me. This episode
of
Wednesday. And hopefully people will be adding you and chase you for more recommendations.
If anyone wants to book me as well, feel free to just message me on Facebook.
Oh, yeah, that would be, of course, if you need a referee, if you listen to this and there's shows happening, and it's safe, and there's no social distancing
once
needed.
Everything's opened up properly, then I'll take bookings.
that's a way better way of saying it. But thank you very much.
I'm not saying that. But thank you for having me. Cool.